welcome to this Talks at GS session. My name's Ian Drayton. It's my great pleasure and privilege to introduce Weijian Shan to you all. Shan has just published his memoirs entitled Out of the Gobi, and it's very much this book that will be the basis of our conversation today. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Ian. Thank you, everyone, for being here. I'm really honored and privileged to be able to talk with you about my book. I wrote this book as a recount of history. The most recent part of Chinese history is a collection of some bitter and sweet stories from my personal experiences during that period of time. And the history, I think, is the most horrific part of China's recent past, but also includes some promising part in the Chinese history. The stories are unique, but at the same time, I think they very much represent the experiences of my generation. And I think that part of the history is important because I believe that the history of a country informs and defines the present day of that country. So that history needs to be remembered and needs to be understood in order to understand China today.
So let's just go back to the Cultural Revolution. Obviously, at the time that it started, so 1966, you were almost 13 years old. You didn't know at that point in time that the Cultural Revolution, which lasted for 10 years, was going to literally take place during your entire teenage years, and also that you would have no formal education for such an extended period of time. So how did you think about that? How did you get yourself through this experience?
There was not much thinking. You know, I was 12, 13 years old, and I was blissfully ignorant, as all my peers. And it was an exciting time, and we didn't know that anything was wrong. We thought that we were doing the right things. Everybody else was doing the right things. And we were answering the calls of Chairman Mao. But after 2 to 3 years, then you start to miss school. You know, you actually can miss school. When I was in school, I never thought I would ever miss school. But after you were out of it for such a long time, you started to miss school. And it was at that time we were sent to the Gobi Desert. And initially, I thought it was another adventure. And I was not so sad, other than at that point of departure from my family, I thought I was going to see something completely new. But we quickly became disillusioned once we arrived there to see how futile our existence was in that part of the world, because we were not producing anything.
When you were in the desert, did you keep a diary? Because as I was reading your book, a lot of the episodes seem to me to have been meticulously chronicled. And so were you keeping a diary with a view to one day recording your experiences? I.e., were you appreciative of the time that you were going through an intense period of history? Or was this just something that you did, you always kept a diary?
I've kept a diary since 1971, and I still have them. Therefore, when I was writing this book, it was very easy to refer back to particular days, what happened. I wrote a particular incident when I was sleeping on ice in this reed shelter, and all of a sudden I felt a movement on my shoulder or under my shoulder blade, and then I quickly realized it was a rat, because even rat somehow got onto the ice and was seeking warmth. And I tried to crush this rat to death with my weight, and I was not successful. He got away. And I could pinpoint the exact date that happened from my diary. But it was also very risky to keep a diary. So all my subversive thoughts were not recorded in the diary.
A couple of things here. One, how did you get hold of books? And two, what was the favorite book you read during your period in the Gobi Desert?
I read books randomly. Sometimes I saw a chemistry textbook of high school. I would read it, and then the next week I discover a chemistry textbook for junior high school, and then I would read it. So it's kind of upside down, whatever came my way. At one time, I didn't have anything to read. The only thing I had was the insecticide manual. So I became an expert on insecticides. And today, if your home is infested by roaches, I know how to deal with it, if you just give me some chemicals. So it was not systematic at all. When it comes to English, my family was split up. Five members were broken into four pieces. But my father stayed in Beijing together with my brother. He sent me English-Chinese dictionary, and that really was the basis of my English education. I just read that dictionary.
Interesting. Okay. So
favorite books. Yeah. I read so many books that none of them is really my favorite one, but there are many favorite ones as well. I just learned in life that authorities should not be respected, and therefore authorities should be defied, because very often they make no sense at all. When we were there, I understand that our leaders were not making any sense by putting us there, subjecting us to that kind of hardship for no particular good purpose. It was all very futile. So I always read books with a grain of salt, and I became very cynical. Mm. But of course, you do learn a lot of things from books, and I love, for example, Mark Twain, because he's also very cynical. And people like Maupassant, a cynical writer as well.
Mm. Let's move now from your period of exile, if you will. You go back to Beijing, and then you become one of the first Chinese students in the US after the Cultural Revolution. So can you tell us a little bit about your move abroad?
I always believe that the opportunity comes to me, and if I was not prepared to capture the opportunity, it would be my fault. So, and I believe that people could live through their life without any opportunities at all. I've seen this repeatedly in history, and then you shouldn't blame yourself, because that's God's will. And so I was always preparing myself, and when China started to open up, I had two opportunities as everybody else, but I suppose I was more prepared. One was when the United Nations came to China to recruit simultaneous interpreters. They did this through a nationwide examination process, and I was recruited, luckily. And then the Asia Foundation, a congressional-sponsored foundation, also came to China to select visiting scholars through an examination system, and I did pretty well in that exam. I was placed number one in that exam. So I was given the choice, or the choices, of three schools to go to. Or I could pick one of them to go to. The first one was Stanford. So the president of my university said, Stanford, I've never heard of this school. Have you? I said, no. We were so ignorant about America, so we didn't know anything about so many things. So I never heard of Stanford. He said, that must be an obscure school. I couldn't send you to, you did so well in your exam. I couldn't send you there. So that was taken off the list. The second one was University of California at Berkeley. In China, some well-known universities have the names of the places associated with them, like Beijing University, Xiamen University. Of course, everybody heard about California. He said, that must be a very good school, University of California. But at Berkeley, that sounds like a branch school. In China, if you don't qualify for the main campus, you're sent to the branch campus. So I can't send you to a secondary type of branch school. So we dismissed that one. The third one on the list was University of San Francisco. It says San Francisco. San Francisco. That's where I went. But the school was very generous to me. And I must say that I'm extremely grateful to University of San Francisco, which really got me started in the American educational system.
Where do you think China would be today if it had not gone through that 10-year period of chaos?
I think that when you look at how China has developed in the past 40 years, what really drove China's economic growth? I read so much about the reference to the so-called China model. And what is China model? You know, the China model is presented as very different from liberal markets, the Western economic system. But in my experience, when I was working as a hard laborer in the Gobi Desert, all economic activities were controlled by the government. There was no private economic activity at all. Every private activity, like if you raise chicken, was considered as a capitalistic tail, which had to be cut. And under that particular system, where was China economically? Chinese economy was in ruins. We couldn't even feed ourselves. We starved all the time. And China was a basket case when it comes to its economy. And so how did China develop? China developed by abandoning that old system of central control and central planning by embracing 40 years ago the market economy. And China's growth trajectory is the one that follows the development of a market economy to such extent that today private sector represents more than 60% of China's GDP. So without knowing the harsh lessons of the so-called socialism during the Cultural Revolution and during my Gobi days, I think many people probably under the communist ideology be very hesitant to embark upon economic reforms in the direction of the market. It was 40 years ago under Deng Xiaoping that a consensus was built that China had to abandon the old system of central planning and had to embrace the market, which really saved China. And that's what I mean by not understanding the hardship of the old system. You wouldn't appreciate where China is and where China needs to go.
Given China's success over the past decades, what would your advice be to Western political leaders today, like to the US, for example?
Well, at this particular moment, I think the US-China relationship is becoming rather tense. And I suspect that the relationship is going to get worse before it gets better, or if it will ever get better. And I'm somewhat puzzled by it. And I'm also, of course, concerned about where this relationship goes. I think that 40 or more than 40 years ago, when the two countries first established a relationship, the differences between the two countries were as wide as possible. China was a closed economy, closed system. America was an open society and liberal democracy. And yet, the countries were able to find common grounds and common interests to build a relationship. And I would say that period of time was almost like a honeymoon. Talking about a honeymoon, you know, today, I think many Americans, especially American China watchers, are unhappy with where China is today. Mm. And if you look at the trade war, it seems that it's not only the administration behind the trade war. There seems to be bipartisan support for the trade war. What has happened, I think many in America are disappointed that China has not gone as far as they hope China will go politically and economically. That reminds me of something that I read in Reader's Digest many years ago, which says that man marries woman hoping she will never change. Woman marries man hoping she will change him. Both are disappointed. And when you think about it, there's some truth to it, right? And I think that can probably describe US-China relationship as well. Many Americans hope that China will change, but they're disappointed because China probably has not changed to the extent that they would like. And China didn't know that America changed, and therefore now they have this tension. But I think if both countries focus on common interests, now economically, the two economies are so integrated. And if they focus on the fact that Goldman Sachs has a market in China, and Goldman Sachs can also help Chinese firms to build a business in America, maybe they can build a better relationship.
We'll try that.
it all depends on you.
Okay, as I was reading through this book, I think one of the things that really resonated with me, and I would expect to resonate with this audience as well, is the fact that you have faced so many challenges in your life, and I really would encourage all of you to read the book because this comes out very starkly, and you face them with grit and with resilience. And so the one quote that, you know, I would like to share with everyone here was towards the end of the book, and this was, I think, the second time that you hadn't been selected to go back to university in Beijing, where you were very composed in front of everyone when you heard the news, and it wasn't because of your academic results, but more because of the relationship you had with the political leaders there, I think. You left the compound very composed, and you walked out into the desert, and then you screamed your lungs out. But you wrote, and here's the quote, "To give up was to commit a sin against myself. I reminded myself time and time again, and I would never give up." Is that something that's propelled you through life?
Well, I don't think that I have so much wisdom to share with the audience, but what really guided me was this notion that I should not give up. I should always prepare. If life is so cruel as not to provide me with the opportunities, it's not my fault, but if opportunities come, if I'm not prepared, it is my fault. So I should never, ever give up. And that's how I was telling me whenever there was a setback at that time.
Okay, Shan, thank you very much. I think I speak on behalf of everyone here at Goldman Sachs. This was a fascinating discussion, and we look forward to reconvening when your second book is out. Thank you very much, everyone.